Hi everybody, I'm Laura Byrne, editor at Tampa Bay Parenting Magazine, but I am also a Hillsborough County homeowner, taxpayer, and I have two little boys who are students in the Hillsborough County School Public System. And I know right now we all have a lot of big questions, a lot of important questions about the proposed millage that's going to be on our ballot to come the primary, and we want to get some of those questions answered because we really do want you to make an informed decision coming up in August. You know, a lot of these questions, I know the big thing is, let's first of all talk about the timing. This is a very hard time right now for families between inflation. We've seen the cost of everything go up. This has got to be a pretty difficult proposal to ask taxpayers to pay even more.
Absolutely. First of all, thanks for being here and having us. And it is a very challenging time. But also look at it from the perspective of being able to fill quality positions for our students every single day. And this is about trying to find proactive solutions that care for teachers, which is caring for students. We ended last year with 400 instructional vacancies, meaning that 8,000 students didn't have a highly qualified skilled teacher. And that is majorly concerning. Going into this school year, we have over 700 instructional vacancies, and I just couldn't wait any longer. We, you know, openly, we look at the funding that we get from the state and legislation, and from a local perspective, it's just not enough to be able to build salary schedules that recruit and retract and also retain our best and our brightest every single day. So we understand the timing may not be the best, but every day I wait is a possibility of me not being able to recruit a first-round draft pick to put in front of our children every day.
You know, you talked about that funding coming from the state. The one thing that stopped me in my tracks, and I didn't realize this, and I feel like maybe I should have been paying more attention, that the state actually mandated that the school millage rate be reduced over the years.
Yeah, that's correct. If you look at what's going on, the millage rate to 2012-2013, the mill was at 5.6%. That was 5.6 what we were levying from a local perspective. Over the last 10 years, it's declined to where we currently are at 3.6. Once this millage passes, because I want to be positive about it, it will be at a 4.6, which means we'll be paying less than we did back in 2012 and 2013. If the state would have kept it the same in 2012-2013, we would have realized $975 million that we would have been able to build compensation packages that are so attractive that we would be able to recruit and attract and retain our best and our brightest every single day, and also offer some really cool initiatives for our children to allow them to discover endless possibilities.
Now, there was not other funding provided, though, to make up for that loss, was there?
No, there's not additional funding at all. So, you know, we want to continue to push. We got to continue to push our legislators to advocate for more money on the basic student allocation. That will really help us, and let that be, you know, given to the school districts to have that flexibility. And that flexibility will be able to allow us to really address our individual unique needs and perspectives from Hillsborough County.
Now let's talk about this proposal. What exactly are you asking of the taxpayers here in Hillsborough County?
We're asking for an increase in one mill. And what that brings is, if we look at the average home, median home in our community, that's around $250,000. You know, what that would bring in request of that homeowner is $225 annually. And if you look at that, what that cost per day is, that's 67 cents per day. That's less than a cup of coffee. And we understand that this may be a trying time, but $225 may be a lot for someone, but especially with inflation, we look at what we deal with gas prices. But holistically, when we talk about education, education is the foundation of a community. And you know, whether you have someone in the system or not, a child perspective, from a child, if anyone has a student, that's going to allow us to put, you know, a certified teacher within in front of our children to help them grow intellectually, socially, emotionally. But even if you do not have someone in our school district any longer, and you talk about, you know, someone may have already graduated, this is about being able to look at stability, being able to prepare students to be successful, being able to prepare them to go to post-secondary, to the military, or to the workforce, and have a real good plan that allows them to be successful. But it's also about safety, keeping our students in our school. And for those who may not have individuals in our school district, we have to build a foundation of individuals that is going to be able to take care of our elderly and build a bench for healthcare down the road. So I think all that inclusive is going to allow us to better understand what we need from the mill perspective.
I think a lot of people have questions of exactly how this money is going to be spent and how you're going to stay accountable with this money. The district, let's be honest, doesn't have the best history when it comes to accountability and the money.
Yeah, sure. Looking at it from a historical perspective, I can't speak to. The only thing I can speak to the last 2.5 years, we've been fiscal responsible. I've had to make some very tough decisions in this district in the last 2.5 years, cutting 1,000 positions, renegotiating contracts, luckily abandoned contracts, looking at energy efficiency mechanisms, looking at transportation efficiency mechanisms, cutting overtime. We've had to make some very hard decisions to be fiscal responsible. Biggest thing is accountability for this. You know, as the half cent penny tax was passed, there was an oversight committee that currently led by Betty Castor that really put together a committee of community members that's looking over every dollar and every cent and matching it to our priorities. We're going to do the same thing. We have a citizens advisory council committee that's been put together in the last 6 months. They've agreed to take on the role and responsibility of navigating through this funding to make sure it's spent where at least 75% has to be going to compensate all of our employees. We're losing teachers, support staff, bus drivers, food nutrition, school-based leaders. And the remaining 25% is to be used to expand visual performing arts and physical education. We have 15,000 youngsters that do not have accessibility to art, music, and PE. And then also workforce development. We have to be able to be on the forefront with career technical education opportunities, which is historically known as vocational opportunities, to allow our students to identify pathways, allow them to transition to a livable wage in the workforce.
And for teachers, how much of a raise is this going to work out? I know that we've seen that number $4,000 thrown around for some teachers, not every single teacher, but how is that going to really break down to help?
Yeah, so all this has to be negotiated through the board and through our local unions and associations. And we took the average, which is going to be an increase of our employees around 6.5%. That's $4,000 for instructional staff. That's $2,000 for non-instructional staff. But it could be greater. There's, looking at scales and determining the money, it could be between $2,000, $10,000, or $15,000. Just depends on how the board and our bargaining units get together to be able to properly compensate. What we have to do is touch every employee in this organization to show a sense of care. We do know that early educators and brand new teachers got an increase in pay in the last 2 years. And that's 1/3 of our workforce, and we're thankful for Tallahassee putting more money into our new teachers and making it more attractive. But 2/3 of our workforce have not been touched in a positive manner from a compensational perspective. And those are individuals who are in the middle or the end of their career, and we're going to have to put something so attractive to be able to keep them in our schools, just to really to have consistency and stability, and those that really understand have not only the pedagogy, but also the content knowledge to be able to activate learning every day.
And one comment that I've seen a lot too is, well, can't you just get the money or figure it out or balance the budget better and give teachers pay raises? Money doesn't just appear.
I wish it did appear. I think the biggest thing is for this community to understand what we've done the last 2.5 years has made some very tough decisions. I mean, we moved, and I believe it was October, November 2020, I moved 400 teachers from one location to the next location in effort to be more fiscal responsible so we didn't have to hire new positions based on student allocation. That was so unpopular. And then also cutting the over 1,000 positions, is something that I would never do as an educator. So I want this community to understand that we have put every strategy we can in place to be able to meet the 3% threshold outlined by the state of Florida. However, when looking at this, we're at a part where if we do not address, and become competitive with the surrounding counties, we're gonna suffer. 21 counties in the state of Florida out of 67 have went out for an increased meal to address compensation. The surrounding counties, Sarasota, Manatee, Pinellas, all have an increased meal in additional salary schedules, and we do not. Pasco's going out now, Polk's going out next year. If we do not ask and create this asset community, and this does not get passed, then the achievement gap will be exacerbated more. We will see that our seasoned teachers will continue to leave in droves. We've got to do something to show the value within this organization to be able to compete locally. And this is about having a lens of equity, not only internally with our schools, but equity across our students being able to compete with other students across the state.
And you brought that up of if it doesn't pass, is there a plan B? What do you do if it doesn't pass? What happens then?
We're going to stay positive and say that we're going to do everything we can to champion this to the finish line. But openly, if it doesn't pass, we can just go ahead and realize that the great resignation is in front of us. And we'll have more open classrooms. We'll have more, we have larger class sizes as we move students from one class to the next. We'll have more teachers that will be burned out because they're covering classes. And that's just unfair. It's unfair to students. It's unfair to our workforce. You know, for us, we'll continue to look at every proactive solution within our budget to make certain we can find some wiggle room to show a little bit of appreciation. But this millage gives us sustainability for 4 years and gives us an opportunity to show analytics and data points that this has helped us bring and attract more stronger workforce to for our students, and then also seeing greater student outcomes.
Now, with the, you have the committee, but will just members of the community be able to see what's going on and track what's going on as well to make sure that these dollars, is it going to be pretty open and transparent?
Absolutely. We will have a website that we put up the same way we leveraged it with ESSER, same way we did with COVID. We had a COVID dashboard. We were the first in the state to do it. We were the first in the state to look at ESSER funds and show the community how we were spending the federal dollars. We will do the same thing with this type of funding, just to have transparency so the community can really feel, you know, that everything that we've asked them from a financial perspective, that we're promises made, promises kept in this initiative.
So how, what would you say to that parent out there who does have a child in the school system, but maybe they're struggling financially? How do you encourage them to vote for this time around?
You know what, we understand there's some complexities, but right now we are starving to be able to put talent in front of our children. You know what, every parent wants their child to have a better education, a better experience, a better life than we had. I want that for my daughters every single day, so does my wife. But at the end of the day, that can't happen if we don't have certified teachers in front of them, helping them activate knowledge, helping them socially, emotionally, intellectually, every single day. So I'm asking them to make that sacrifice of $225 annually or $300 annually, whether we don't go out to the McDonald's a couple times, whether we substitute the ice cream, all to be able to give our children and their children a fighting chance every single day in our classrooms.
I think the good question, this important question here is for people who don't have a student in the Hillsborough County Public School System. Maybe they pay for private school, so why should they vote for this and increase their tax bill?
I think the biggest thing is to, you know, we talk about bringing newcomers to the Tampa region, Hillsborough County. We're talking about bringing new families. We're talking about bringing new organizations, new companies. All that comes with a thriving educational system, the foundation. Whether individuals go to private school, public schools, it doesn't matter. Education is the foundation of a thriving community. So just understanding the all the benefits that we create, it's also a safer mentality, being able to keep our students into our schools and off the street and all out of our communities during the day. It just gives them a sense of hope and being able to leverage, you know, all of the offerings that we have for them to have career pathways, and also being able to look at the economic, the, you know, positive economic impact of having individuals that are fluent in literacy, that are mathematical, you know, competent, that being able to problem solve, decision make, all that comes from having a great stability educational system along the way.
And we just want to bring this up too, because we did approve a couple years ago the referendum to help improve our schools. That money is totally separate, correct?
Absolutely.
That's totally different. So maybe people are like, would that money go to something? Why can't you use that to pay teachers?
It's a great question. You know, first and foremost, thank you to this community for passing the referendum in 2018, 2019. That was solely designed to address the $1 billion of deferred maintenance. And we don't get categorical money to be able to do that at scale. And what that does, that money allows us to expand student stations by building new schools, adding new wings, allows us to address any safety issues and measures from a facility perspective, and allows us to address technology within our schools. That money has to be used for those particular areas because that's the way that the information was drafted in the ballot language. The same thing with the mill. The millage increase is only going to allow us to address operating expenses and what we define the needs are. And the needs are to increase compensation for our employees, expand visual performing arts and physical education, and also expand workforce development. So they're very different, both very needed, because from the operation side, I got to build 18 schools in the next 15 years. And we talk about inflation, you know, we see that, you know, cost of construction has gone up 90% over the last year. And at the other side of it, you know, we need additional money from our local legislators to be able to address the unique perspective of our school district. So very different, both definitely needed.
but it's going to stick with what's in the ballot language. That is only what you're not going to change your mind 2 years from now and decide you're going to spend the money somewhere else.
We legally cannot. We're statutorily required and bounded to be able to follow the language that's presented to the community. We will never do that. And this is why the Citizens Financial Advisory Council will be in place. And also, I'll have my own internal organization controls of the school board that make sure that these dollars and cents are spent in the way that we present it to the community.
And if people have more questions, how can they reach out to you or to your staff to get everything answered?
Yeah, so our website at hillsboroughschools.org has a link to go on. They can navigate through that link. It has FAQs, it has information, it also has a number of data sets to show where we were historically, what the finances will go through, all that they can educate themselves and inform them. As a school district, we can't tell our viewers or we can't tell our community members how to vote, whether yes or no. We can only arm them with information, and we'll continue to do that to make sure they're informed to make a sound decision.
And will you try again if it fails this time around?
Absolutely. We will never give up, and the groundwork will be established. And you know, every day, as I said, every day that we wait is a potential day that a student is not able to thrive because they don't have consistencies in their classrooms.
All right, so just what do we need to know then about letting our voices be heard?
You know what, the biggest thing is to make sure that everyone's registered to vote. The last day to register is July 25th, and early voting takes place between August the 8th and August the 21st. And the day of the primary vote will be on August 23rd. So we encourage everyone to be actively engaged, do your homework, and you know, continue to support public education as we help our children be successful.